Well, now we're going to get a chance to actually walk around the plane with Buzz Carpenter, who actually flew it. Now, this nose cone comes off, doesn't it?
It's actually three noses. There's a training nose that looks like the nose you see there. The radar nose has a similar external view. And if the optical camera was in, we called it the country's camera because it took a picture 72 miles wide. There was a big glass window that came along the hole from either side of the nose that the camera fit into.
Now, four bolts held this on?
Only four bolts held the nose on because the air pressure as you're flying along is keeping the nose very firmly in place, and the four bolts is all they required, which made it easier on the ground for them to swap out noses if the mission was changed.
Now tell me about the camera that would be on board here. There was a little bit of film in there, right?
The camera in the nose, which took that picture 72 miles wide, the film itself was 5 inches wide, 2 miles long. So when you landed and the photo maintenance people took it down, they had quite a job because they had to take the nose and the film back to the photo lab, cut it into 500-foot lengths, put on cotton surgical gloves, go the whole length of the film to make sure there's no cuts or tears, and then put it in for processing.
So it wasn't a very fast process to get the pictures back to somebody on the ground to actually look
at. That's correct, and that's part of the reason this airplane was retired, because it took a while, hours, sometimes measured in days, to get the information that had been requested to the people who had requested it.
Now, there are some little blisters that you see, little bumps along the airplane in different spots. Tell me about those.
The little blisters on the nose of the aircraft look forward, and they're looking for air-to-air and surface-to-air radars. The blisters on the bottom and some other hidden antennas, if they launched a missile at us, they would then come in and start a jamming process, which basically denied the missile that had been fired at us any update information. So typically the missile went stupid. We had a couple hundred missiles fired at us. I personally never had one. The closest missile to the airplane was about a mile and a half in trail behind us.
And was that because the plane was that much faster than the missiles or because of the jamming as well?
A combination. You're at 85,000 feet. You're hard to see on radar. You're traveling at almost 2,200 miles an hour. Very difficult target to intercept.
Now, I notice you've got a pin on your lapel. Can you tell me about that?
When you had your first Mach 3 flight, they met you and they gave you one of these pins that Lockheed had created. When you'd flown 300 hours, you got a second pin. When you flew 600 hours, you had another pin that had 600 hours on it. There were about 19 people that made it to 900 hours. I never got that high. And we had, I think, three people that had over 1,000 hours, but that was pretty unusual.
Now the cockpit on this, when you see the inside of it, it doesn't really look like a modern day cockpit, does it?
It wasn't. It was basically a late 50s, like an F-4 cockpit or fighters of that time. When Kelly Johnson accepted the challenge from President Eisenhower, he had so many technical challenges to fly an airplane at these speeds and deal with the heat that he said, I'm not gonna mess with a cockpit if it works. So it's a standard old round dial with a lot of additional switches and gauges to deal with supersonic flight.
The windows on here, and actually the whole plane, got a little bit warm as you were flying, right?
That's correct. Because flying at 2,100 miles an hour, the skin temperature, the average temperature was over 600 degrees. You couldn't use aluminum, so the airplane is 93% titanium. One of the interesting facts is all the titanium came from Russia. They never knew who they sold it to build 32 of these airplanes. As you look up in the cockpit, the small triangular windows there are about 620 degrees. My side windows were about 580, and it's about an inch and a half quartz glass, much like your oven glass at home. And that's what was protect the crew members. The navigator's windows were more in the range of about 480 degrees, but they're hot. You can't hold your hand against the window for more than 5 or 10 seconds at most, even in your spacesuit, before it's just too hot to touch.
Wow. Now, when this plane took off, it almost immediately had to have a refueling scheduled, right?
It did that because of the 12 airplanes we lost, four of them, either the primary cause or a significant secondary, was tire failure. So we reduced, instead of taking off with 80,000 pounds of fuel, we took off with 40,000 pounds of fuel. It reduced the wear and tear on the tires. And the second thing, right after liftoff, had we lost an engine, there wasn't enough airflow across the airplane to keep it right. It would roll over on itself and crash, much like the Concorde did at Charles de Gaulle. So to get through that dead zone quicker, we took off with half a fuel load.
So how many times would you have to refuel on a normal mission?
Normal mission was 2.5 to 4.5 hours, and that'd be one or two refuelings. My longest was 10 hours and 20 minutes, and that was five refuelings. When these airplanes during the Arab-Israeli war flew from the East Coast into the Middle East and back for the president, it was anywhere from 5 to 6 refuelings. Every 2 hours, you had to come down and either refuel at 25,000 feet or you had to come into land.
Now, there's a little Star Wars connection here. Can you tell me about that?
When I give tours, I talk to the kids. We have an R2-D2 on this platform. From the British, we were able to get a very sophisticated system. Now, this is in the 60s, that you would upload all the information about the mission, tell the airplane exactly where it was on the face of the Earth. We would start the engines. When we taxied out of the hangar, there's a sensor on the back of the airplane, a glass eye, that looks through the blue sky and locks on the stars. We guaranteed the president anywhere in the world traveling at 2,200 miles an hour within 300 feet. This is long before GPS. We were not dependent on ground information to verify our position.
And it's basically in the same spot that R2-D2 rode in their spaceship.
That's exactly right.
Well, we've moved a lot closer to the plane, and as you get closer, you can see there are some pretty significant gaps here. Can you tell us about those?
Because of the heating on the airplane, an average temperature of over 600 degrees, overhead here, this is the most significant gap. The airplane grows 3 to 4 inches in length, and this particular gap here can expand anywhere from 1 to 2 inches to account for the heating that the titanium metal goes through as the airplane goes into cruise. There's a couple other expansion joints on the airplane, but this is the most significant one. And the airplane grows 1 to 2 inches in width also because of the heating. Inside the engine, because heated the core of the engine to 2,000 degrees and the afterburner to 3,200 degrees, the engine actually grows 6 inches in length and a couple inches in width to accommodate this tremendous heating that it sustains for an hour and a half at a time.
How hot would the outside of the plane get?
The outside of the airplane, the coolest part was about 450 degrees. The hottest part of the exterior of the airplane was over 1,200 degrees.
And this plane wasn't designed with the software and everything that we have today, was it?
It was not. And some of you may or may not have seen these before. This is the last major airplane built in the United States using a slide rule, both the aircraft and the engine. And years later, they went back to look using a computer model, and they found out from the computer model they would have designed the airplane exactly the same way.
It's pretty amazing what you could do with a non-battery powered slide rule.
Exactly right.
That's amazing. Now we've moved back in front of the engine. Can you tell us about the engines on this plane?
This was the most difficult job that Kelly Johnson had, and Ben Rich designed the inlet, because no engine, even today, can absorb supersonic air. So at some point you have to adjust the airflow. And the purpose of the spike here is that this is a subsonic position. When you hit 1.6 Mach, the spike, 1.6 Mach is about 1,000 miles an hour, the spike will start moving aft. It'll double the size of the opening. And in the back of the spike area, it will narrow, and so the air is automatically compressed before it hits the first compressor blade. And the amazing thing about this engine, it's really three parts. It's the inlet in the front that, starting at 1.6 Mach, will start translating back and double the size of the opening. And in the back, it'll slow the air down, because no jet engine, even today, can absorb supersonic air. In the center, you have a turbo jet engine, and at the higher speeds, it becomes a turbo ram engine, because it's going to bypass a lot of the air around the engine back into the afterburner, which is the third critical part. This is the only inlet engine afterburner combination in the world that the faster we went, the less fuel we burned, because it became more like a ramjet. At 2,100 miles an hour, 80-some percent of the thrust came from the ram thrust, per se.
Now, this plane would make a pretty impressive sonic boom.
We called it the sound of freedom. And 2 points off this airplane, a shock would come off, and about 45 seconds behind the airplane, much like the space shuttle, it has the same configuration. Can you imagine that sometimes we were tasked by the State Department to overfly heads of state? The 3 nights before we invaded Panama, an SR-71 visited Panama to fly over his house to kind of remind him, it's time to leave, the forces are on the way. One of the most interesting stories that we just found out about, in March of this year, the Smithsonian released a video that talked about the secret spies of Hanoi. And it turns out 3 SR-71s were tasked to overfly Hanoi out of Japan and cross almost simultaneously. We thought it was just a message to the POWs that helps on the way, we support you. As it turns out, this was a message that had been approved by President Nixon to Admiral Stocksdale that said, when you hear the sound of thunder, there are Navy rescue teams off the coast. If you feel you can escape from the prison and make it down the river, there'll be Navy frogmen, SEALs, to meet you and to take you home. And it was the first we ever knew about it was when the March film was released.
That's incredible that it not only did it serve the spy missions, but also as a signaling mission.
As a signaling mission.
That's cool. Can you tell us about unstarts and sympathetic unstarts?
Because this airplane at the high speeds basically was a ramjet, it was absolutely critical that the shock wave stay inside the inlet to reduce the drag and to produce the thrust we required. If you had a disturbance because of air or temperature and the shock came out, what you had was one inlet engine combination was producing 20% thrust, the other was producing 100% thrust momentarily, and the airplane would start a violent slice and could pitch up on you. It could be so violent, on one of the flights during an emergency, my sun visor on my spacesuit was broken when the cockpit hit me. I mean, the airplane was violent. So what they developed was when one inlet would unstart, the other inlet would sympathetically unstart, so both spikes would come forward and hopefully you'd keep symmetrical thrust. It didn't always work, but that was what had been installed in the airplane to make flying this airplane a lot easier. During my time flying the airplane over 5+ years, I had over 100 unstarts. It was not a particularly, it was a very dramatic event, and you had your full attention to keep the airplane flying straight ahead.
Incredible. You can see that we've moved underneath the Blackbird and we're looking at the tires, but these aren't just ordinary tires, are they?
They are not. They're 22 ply and they're filled with nitrogen to 415 pounds per square inch. And the reason you don't use air is as you get up in the flight and the tires would heat up, even though they're in a protective cell per se, the oxygen in the air would go into the rubber. So when you came back, all 6 of your main tires, which were critical, would all be flat. We lost 12 of the SR-71s in accidents. 4 of them were because of tire failure was a major, either the primary cause or a major contributor. And these are brand new tires you see here. There's no tread on them. They have little dimples. And tires like this would be good for about 15 landings, and then you'd have to replace them.
Now, how fast were you going when you took off?
When you took off, you lifted off doing about 240 miles an hour. So these tires were approaching their stress limit at that point. When you landed, you touched down typically doing about 175 to 180 miles an hour.
Now you flew this plane that we're underneath, didn't you?
I did. I had over 10 missions in this airplane. I have over 65 hours. It was one of my favorite airplanes because it always flew very well.
Well, thank you so much for joining us here with the SR-71 Blackbird.
Marty, it's been my pleasure, and I hope that the students find this airplane as fascinating as I found it during the time I flew it.